in English and greater opportunities to take part in international exposure activities. Our department also offers double degree programs. These particular programs are held in collaboration with the University of Queensland and Wren School of Business. Students will study at ITS and partner universities to get 2 undergraduate degrees. We provide students the opportunities to take international mobility activities such as excursion studies, exchange programs, short course programs, international internships, and many others. Our department will warmly welcome foreign students to experience these international exposure opportunities. To support those activities, Business Management ITS have several international partners. There are 2 laboratories to promote researches at Business Management ITS, which are Business Analytics and Strategy Laboratory and Entrepreneurship and Small Medium Enterprise Laboratory. Business Analytics and Strategy Laboratory, or the BAS Laboratory, focuses on operation management, strategic management, finance, and accounting. There are 10 lecturers and researchers associated with the BAS Laboratory. Business Analytics and Strategy Laboratory have several assistants to support its day-to-day operations. Entrepreneurship and Small Medium Enterprise Laboratory, or the ESME Laboratory, focuses on marketing, entrepreneurship, human resource management, performance measurement, and data envelope analysis. There are 9 lecturers and researchers associated with the ESME Laboratory. The Entrepreneurship and Small Medium Enterprise Laboratory, also supported by several assistants to carry out the laboratory programs. Our department have more than 500 alumni. They work at different fields and industries such as national and multinational companies, government, or even became an entrepreneur.
Let's join Business Management ITS and be the future business leader.
Okay, a very good afternoon to all of you. My name is Maria Angelia Krishna Wijayanti. Student from Department of Business Management will be the MC for today. To the International Guest Lecture Series with today's topic, Market Research in Practice from Department of Business Management ITS. And may the blessings of the Almighty God be with us. Thank you to all participants for joining our Zoom meeting this afternoon. Before we start our event today, please allow me to share the protocols of video conference. Okay. First, please kindly adjust your name or ID screen using the format your name underscore department or general. Second, during the video conference, we kindly ask all participants to turn on the mute mode or turn off the audio and only turn on the audio when MC or moderator give the suggestion. Third, we would like to recommend all participants to adjust the seat position comfortably and prevent the backlight effect. Fourth, please ensure your network has a stable internet connection for your convenience during the event. The next one, we recommend all participants to use a headset or earphones for clear and better sound. In addition, we kindly ask all participants to fill the online attendance list through the link provided in the chat room in the middle of the session. And don't forget, please turn off or mute your video, your voice during the guest lecture. Thank you for your attention. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this event will be started soon. Let me greet the lecturers who join us this afternoon. Hello, Mr. Satria, Mr. Bustano, Mrs. Dewi, Mrs. Anandita, Mrs. Nindi. How are you?
Very good.
Good, good. Very good.
Well, I hope it's a great day for all of us. And also a warm welcome to other lecturers and all participants here. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome our special speakers who join us today, Dr. Valerie Ritz from Fifth University of Applied Science in Belgium. Hello, Dr. Valerie Ritz.
Hello, how are you?
I'm fine. And how about you?
Fine, thank you. It's starting, it's morning here, so it's okay. a bit different.
Yeah. Thank you for being here. It's good to have you in our department. I hope it's been a great day for you, and we are all very excited to hear the lecture from you. Today, Dr. Valerie Ritz will be sharing and discuss about market research in practice. Ladies and gentlemen, before going to the main event, I would like to invite one of our lecturers, Dr. Satria Fadil Persada, as the moderator who will lead our discussion and today's agenda. I hope all of us are given good health and stay safe in this time of the pandemic. Without further ado, to Dr. Satria Fadil Persada to lead our today's agenda, place and time is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Maria. Good afternoon for Indonesian participants, respected audiences, and then good morning for Dr. Valerie. I believe this is morning at your time, right?
Yes, yes. That's why also it's not so clear, the picture. It's still a bit dark here.
So it's still, you need more coffee to punch.
Yes, definitely, definitely. I'm at home. I'm hoping my daughters and my husband maybe will provide some. You never know.
Okay. Before we start to the main topic, allow me to share the introduction about our department, and then after that we can move to the main agenda, which is the international guest lecture for Dr. Valerie Ritz. Before that, I'll try to share the screen of this. Sorry. Let me try first, and then share screen for this slide. Okay, before we move to the main topic, I would like to confirm for all the participants, can you see the full picture or the full screen of my PowerPoints?
Yes, sir. It's
so
clear.
So, how about assistance? Can you confirm? Okay, it's clear. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So, before we start on the main topic related to international guest lecture, we would like to introduce you on behalf of Department of Business Management that we announced the International Undergraduate Program, or we call it in the abbreviation of IUP. Okay, Department of Business Management, basically we have four majors, which are the Operation Management and Business Analytics. And then the second one is the Marketing Management and Entrepreneurship, following by the third one is Human Resource Management, and the last one is Accounting and Finance. And then we also have the dual degree cooperation with the University of Queensland and the Renner School of Business, as you see on the video before. And we also have relatively a lot of partners, broad partners. The first one is FIFES, University of Applied Science, the place where that Dr. Valerie Ritz teaching and doing the research.
Indeed,
and then
indeed.
And we have a lot of partners, such as the University of Malaysia Perlis, University of Nottingham, and many more. And then one of the main event of the international undergraduate program opening is the celebration by performing the international guest lecture series, which is one of the event is the international guest lecture series presented by our beloved keynote presenter, Dr. Valerie Ritz, with the topic of market research in practice. So before we start to the main agenda, I would like to show you a brief information about Dr. Valerie Ritz. So Dr. Valerie Ritz was graduated from the University of KU Leuven and also the University of Antwerp at 2000, right? And then Dr. Valerie Ritz, she has so relatively a lot of experience in industry, such as the retail advisor at Dexia Bank, the person in charge for the training center finance at Insurance CBFV at Fifth University of College. And then Dr. Valerie Ritz start focusing on education career from November 2009 to present, which is almost 11 years for doing the education career. And then on the August 2018, Dr. Valerie have the job for the coordinator at Advanced Bachelor International Management Program. So this is the brief information about Dr. Valerie Ritz. At the end of the presentation, you may have the information and the slide from the committee, and then we can start the presentation by allowing Dr. Valerie Ritz to create and to start the international guest lecture series for market research topic. Okay, Dr. Valerie Ritz, without to delay, yes. This is your time.
Yeah, thank you for your nice introduction. I learned also a lot about your university, and when the Corona and COVID period is over, I would really, really like to pay a visit to you. So this was nice. So I'm going to start to share my screen so that everybody can see my topic and my guest lecture. So one moment, please. There it sounds. Is it clear for everyone? I don't see it's moving my.
We see your PowerPoint.
Yes, okay. And I think now. On full screen. Thank you very much. So good morning for me, but also a good afternoon for you. So I'm really excited to share with you some of my experiences on market research in practice. So let's start off with a brief introduction. One moment, I see this. My screen is not moving. I don't know why. it's maybe I have to be a bit more patient. Okay, so as your introduction said, I studied at the University of Antwerp, and then I worked for about 10 years as a consultant in banking and insurance. So this means that also I am a professor of bank and insurance, and also coordinator for the business school finance in insurance. But so my two mains of interest and two mains of expertise lie in this. Today, I'm really going to talk and focus on the practice-based market research. And maybe I hope you will see if I click. I have to be more patient, I think. Doesn't change. I don't know why. Maybe it's, yeah, okay, now you can see. These are some pictures of former assignments that we have done with students, but also on my behalf. As you can see, this is some market research we did for the shopping mall in Kortrijk. Also, we did some market research for a wholesale furniture who also has connections with Indonesia. So that's why I made her picture on it. Also, we worked for Rularta Media Group, and also for the local government of West Flanders. Okay. No, it's going the wrong side. Okay. So enough about me. Let's say something about the content of the lecture I'm going to do with you. First of all, I'm trying to convince you why market research has still its value today. Then I will provide you with the building blocks of strategic market research. And then I will try to clarify these buildings blocks with the case of the Food Savers project. Yeah. Then I will give you some insights about and results from this case. And then to conclude, I will give you a general conclusion and also formulate and conduct a mini quiz with menti.com. Okay. Still, yeah. So first of all, let's think about marketing and marketing research. Yeah? We can say that, I'm sorry, I have issues with my PowerPoint, I see, but sometimes it works. So we can say marketing is without data is like driving with your eyes closed. If you don't know anything, it's really difficult to get your focus on, etc. But you can maybe say to me that today it's all about big data. Yeah? Big data is really big issue, but maybe we could, so why do we still need market research today? I will show you now a little video that explains why big data and why we should care about big data, and then I will focus on the value. I hope you will.
Does the term big data scare or confuse you? Fear not. Let us break it down for you. Big data is the act of collecting large data sets from traditional and digital sources to identify trends and patterns. That information is used by companies to improve what they know about customers' wants and needs. The goal should be to make solid decisions based on data and not just hunches. People are increasingly willing to hand over their personal data in return for products and services that make their lives easier. But what does that mean for you, the source of the data? Well, think of it as a trade. Let's say Becky tweets about a store she recently visited. That store could mine data from her tweet and thousands of others to figure out where its customers are and what they're saying about its products. Maybe the store decides to open a new location way across the city because social media shows the demand there is popping. Tweets and Facebook posts are a bit harder to analyze than structured data like store receipts or web traffic. Unstructured text or images require special software to extract their meaning. And since the volume of unstructured data is so large, many businesses need to use special hardware just to organize and understand it. Companies that are on their game use both structured and unstructured data flow to build up their customer insights each step of the way. Pretty crazy, right? Data-driven marketing is what it's all about these days, and every organization should know the three V's of analysis if they want to succeed. Volume, the amount of data, velocity, the speed at which the data is generated, and variety, the kind of data available. The more data a business analyzes, the more it can make the experience better for the customer. For a typical company, just a 10% increase in data accessibility will bring in more than $65 million additional net income. So should Becky worry that her information is being passed around between large corporations? Maybe. It's not exactly a regulated practice, but in this day and age is nearly impossible to avoid. And data collection is not going anywhere. By the year 2020, about 1.7 megabytes of new information will be created every second for every human being on the planet. Even the White House has already invested more than $200 million in big data projects. But just because information is collected doesn't mean it will necessarily be used. In fact, only 0.5% of all aggregated data is ever analyzed. But there are steps Becky can take to limit the amount of accessible data. She can read the terms and conditions before installing apps. Some of them ask to access phone contacts, GPS locations, even the mic recorder. Limit geotags on social media, and be aware that anything you type into a search engine will be documented, even in private browsing. So there you have it. Big data is the ultimate business tool of the future, and it wouldn't be possible without you, the consumer.
Okay, so I think this
video... Does the term big data scare?
Yeah, why big data is really important today, and I'm really also convinced of the value of big data. So I don't think this is something new for your students. I don't think that, but still it's important. So the main question now remains, why do we need market research or traditional market research today? First of all, I'm sorry.
Does the term
some issues with my PowerPoint? Doesn't work. Okay, so first of all, one of the reasons why traditional market research is still important is that not all companies have access to those big data platforms. As you have seen on the video, we have seen that this is all mainly on social media, but also this costs a lot of money. So this means that non-profit organizations and also small firms and communities do not have access for this. Yeah. Okay. Then big data mainly connects also behavioral data. So what we are doing, how many times have we have been on a certain website or what have we done, but not why we do it. Eh? So this is also very important. I can give you the example of actually somebody who buys, who never buys meat in a supermarket. Eh? This can have two reasons. One of the reasons can see that this person is just a vegetarian person, but also another reason can be that this is for a gastronomic reason, so that only these people are going to buy meat at a specialized store or a specialized butcher shop. So this is really also the difference between quantitative and qualitative research. Big data, they focus mainly on quantitative research and not so on qualitative research. Okay. Also, these big data has these disadvantages. I think also in India, you know, booking.com or Zalando, etc. So sometimes when you are looking for traveling and you have already booked a hotel or etc., but it can be that with booking, you still get promotions and you have been there, for example, etc. So the analysis can be misleading. It's not always correct. And it's also very complex to gain some insights. And the insights in your behavior is very difficult why we do it. Yeah? And also, we need really speedy updates. It goes really fast. People are changing a lot their behavior. And it means that if you have a data platform, it also should really speed up with the data. Okay, another thing that is more and more coming is ad blocking. I even found yesterday another report on actually that in Asia, it's more important even than in Europe. So I think if you really look in if you look at it, that in Indonesia, almost 60% of mobile devices are carrying running on ad blockers. I don't know if this is really correct now, but still, I think it's a big thing. It's not only on mobile devices, but also. So actually, Europe and North America are running behind you guys. So ad blocking is also something that's really important. Also, why is market research still useful? Yeah, sometimes you launch a new product and you know, or a new service, so you cannot have any big data on that. So no data is really available. So this is why I think traditional market research is still useful. Okay. Actually, we have to focus on two main players. Every time you do something about for marketing, you have your customer on the one hand, and the other hand, you have your competitor, both or more, one or more competitor. So you need information from them. So we also can say that actually research is formalized curiosity. It's poking and prying with a purpose. You want to know your customer, you want to know your competitor. Yeah. So first of all, now I have showed you the value of market research. Now I'm going to step onto the second part, and how do we really do good market research? We say that we have to use the scientific method of market research designs, and we have six steps for that. Yeah. I'm going to go through every step with you, exactly what is meant by this, but now I will just give you a preview of all the steps. The first step is identifying the problem. The second step is studying and designing the study. How are we going to do it? Step three is selecting a sample of your target. Step four is actually doing it, gathering the data. Step five is analyzing the results. And step six is then actually communicating your findings and your recommendation. So let's start with step one. Let's take the example of, for example, you see that I will also re-elaborate on that example, housing for elderly people. This is something that is universal for the whole world. We are searching for facilities for housing for elderly people. So identify the problem. What does that mean? Yeah, we have to describe the research objectives. What are we going to do? Second part is understand the background of the problem. Do some desk research. Do you have all your own information or external information about this situation? Then you have to clarify the concepts. What are seniors, etc., etc. And then at last, you have to formulate your hypothesis. What is a hypothesis? It is a statement, an assumption that you make on it. So let's try and do this for housing for elderly people. Okay, so let's say you have your research objective that to what extent are seniors prepared to adapt their house to stay home longer? I think it's the same in Belgium, like, or in Europe or Indonesia, that seniors prefer to stay at home. They don't want to go to a rest house, or they don't want to stay with their children. They just want to stay at home. So this means that to provide, to clarify more of this, you have to do at first some desk research. You have to do two desk research internal. So what do you know already of the topic? If you have had the assignment from the government, for example, to look into this problem, then probably they will provide you with some data on that. Maybe you have your assignment comes from a rest home, then they also will provide you with the information that they have. So this means that you have to really talk to the people that are want to do this market research and ask them for their insights, their first insight information. First step further, what do you do is really you look for information externally. So third persons may have already looked into this problem. So this means that we have to look in what studies already exist about the team, and also maybe if we say we have to adapt their house, what kind of adaptation can be made, like an elevator, for example, but also door handles, or maybe a kitchen should be lower. But I think there are a lot of questions about mobility, because when you get older, it's more difficult to move. But also another thing that's really important is the budget, of course. Normally in Belgium, we have a pension. In Indonesia, you will get something too. But it's really important to know how much budget did we have. have they any savings? Is this normal? So this is really something you have to look into before you really do your market research. Okay. Second, a third thing that we have to do on forehand, so to do in step one, is define the concepts. Eh? If we talk about seniors, yeah, what kind of age do we talk about seniors? I think there is a big difference. I also looked up in Indonesia that at this moment now, I hope you may interrupt me if I say things that were wrong from Indonesia, but I heard and I tried to find that already on 57 years, they can get pension, but that it's going to get later. Is this correct?
Yeah, for non-education, 57, but for a professor, it's up to 65.
Okay, yeah. In Belgium, yeah. It's also 65, but it's getting now to 67. Eh? So I think in all over the country and all over the world, we are really postponing this date and to talk about seniors. Eh? So it's really important when you do market research, for example, on seniors, that you say, okay, let's start from, for example, the age of 60. Eh? The age of 60. And so you define this in the beginning of your research. Also, the concept of a house. Yeah, you have been, if you look all over the world, we have really different housing types. Eh? You have people that live in apartments, but you have also people who have tiny houses or big houses. It depends. So you also have to describe really where do the most of the seniors live. Do they live, for example, with their children already? So this is also important that you have to define your concepts. And also another thing that you have to really describe or define or really say, which is the geographical area I'm going to focus on. If you say I'm going to focus on the whole of Belgium, okay, this is not so big, but if you have to go focus on the whole of India, of Indonesia, it's a big difference. Yeah? So it means that you have to really say, I'm going to look into it on this geographical area. Okay, so before you start, this is more the scientific way of doing a market research, is you have to formulate some hypotheses, so some assumptions. So maybe you can say, if you have divided the seniors in different groups, that 2/3 of the 65 plus seniors aren't aware of the possible adaptations. Is this so? They don't know how you can adapt your house. And for example, also another assumption can be a single senior, 75 plus, prefers to go at a rest home or retirement home to really staying at home. So at a certain age, we prefer maybe to go to a retirement home. And then another assumption can be senior of 65 plus consider adaptations when they have stayed in the hospital. Okay? When they think they are healthy, they don't want to adapt their house. And they say, we don't need the budget for that. So this can also be a hypothesis, an assumption that you make for a good market research. And then the last one I provide to you is 1/4 or 20%. 25% of seniors don't have enough savings to do any adaptation to their home. This is also a serious thing to consider. So this is, for example, four hypotheses you can formulate thinking about market research on senior housing. So this was really step one. So now let's go to step two. Yeah? You have to now, you have already defined in step one the problem. So you have really awesome insights and some assumptions that you have made. So what do you do now is choose the method of market research. You have several methods of market research. I already told you that quantitative is possible. You get quantitative, this means that you have to do a lot of you have to search for a lot of people. The amount is very important. And qualitative research is more insights that you get. And it's more like the motivation studies and also the nonverbal and the motivations why we do something. There are also two main choices you have to make. If you want to do a survey. So you just ask the people that you want to focus on, or actually, do you want to observe the people? So an observation is also an important method, and that is something you can do with an experiment. Okay, good. Then in the second part, you have to think about what questions are you do you have. Do we have a topic list that we have to do, etc. But it's important to draw up some questions, maybe not formulated really prefer at this stage, not really perfectly formulated, but still you have to draw up a topic list. And then you have to focus on actually who am I looking for? What is the population? What is the target group? Who is really the main subject? Like I told you with the senior people. Yeah, okay. And then actually, where can I find these people? Or maybe the people can all be firms. Because market research is not only for consumers. It can be also for clients, and clients can be firms. It depends on which kind of market you are working, B2B or B2C, or actually for a government. So don't really always think about a consumer like really a person, but also maybe like firms or governments or etc. So it's important. Here you can find again to summarize the difference between quanti and qualitative, that you can see here the main differences. You have to structureize questions, you have unstructured questions, it's more experimental. You have large samples. Maybe you know statistically how large a sample should be for quantitative research. Does anybody know? When we talk about large samples, statistically, actually, there is, so if anybody wants to, yes.
Okay, for the students, you can contribute to answer the questions.
They can also answer in chat, for example.
Yes, you can answer by chat or by talking directly. So is there anyone that can answer?
That's always difficult, participating.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea how large a quantitative research at least has to be?
No one asked for? Hello?
Hello, yes. No, nobody? You don't know? Do you have any idea? Actually, from 300, this is enough already. 300, 400. Yeah? So this means that you it's actually not so large. Large is statistically large, but you have to do in several characteristics, characteristics, and it has to be divided. And so, but of course, the larger the better, but still a large sample can already be 300 people. So I know here we have already about, let's say, about a little 200 people. So this is already a nice quantitative little research that we can do if we have to conduct this, okay? So we have the difference between quantitative research and qualitative. Here you have more like small samples. So this means if you have to do, for example, a focus group, you can do this with, let's say, 10 people. And so you have to really have a good idea in which direction you can go. But the difference is that here in quantitative research, you really can be statistically valid, and you can really enlarge for the whole and say statements and make statements for the whole of the population. Yeah, and then here this is not possible, of course, if you just do interviews in depth with observational methods. That this means that you only can say that you have some assumptions that you can make. And maybe sometimes we use this qualitative research here like preparation for the quantitative, to enlarge everything. So here the analyzing is in numbers, how many people responded that and how many people did that. And here You have more the body language that also is important. Is somebody interested in or engaging in it? This means, yeah. Sometimes it's really, really difficult to choose, because what do you have to choose, and what consequences do we have it? So maybe I can. It depends also on the topic. If I would ask to you guys some questions about hygiene, if did you this morning wash your hair, for example, or did you took a bath, or etc. This is something more, most of the people will answer, yes, we did. Because you don't want to be the person that didn't wash yourself. This is, I think, logical. So sometimes it's better than to observe the people. If you can get in their houses and install like a camera and see if they are really doing what they are saying, or are they really do you do what you are saying also? Hello? This means that it's important. I can give you also another video on an experiment that we did in Belgium, in Brussels, with a charity project. It is a bit also a social issue. I think everywhere in the world we are aware of charity programs that are needed, etc., etc. But still, we are also interested in buying cheap clothes, So I will show you a little video of on YouTube. On an experience that was done, and this is really something that's, it's more genuine, the experiment, than just asking to the people. If you ask to the people, will you give money to charity, most of the people will say, because it's social, the social right answer is actually yes, of course I will invest in charity, of course. But I think you also know Primark, etc. So we know the issues. Okay, I will show you the video. Okay. Yes.
Did you show the video from the PowerPoint or from the YouTube?
From YouTube. You cannot see it?
Yeah, maybe you need to stop the share of PPT and share the Google Chrome, because
okay, no
we
problem.
See your
no problem.
PowerPoint.
No, it's important that you interrupt me for this. No problem. Stop share, one moment. And we share again. Yes, I think this is it. You see now YouTube?
Yes, we saw your we see your YouTube.
Okay, thank you. will return now to my PowerPoint. I think it's really important to do sometimes an experiment. One moment. Because if you ask people if you want to donate, I'm sorry, I think I will stop sharing. One moment. Yeah. I think, yes, unfortunately, not on the right slide again. You see now my PowerPoint, I think, but it's not on full screen.
Yes, not full screen yet.
And I can't, it doesn't. Allez, come on. I don't know why it's not reacting sometimes.
Well, Dr. Valerie.
Yes.
When we're still waiting for the full screen, can the student yes. asking about the question or maybe interrupt you in the middle of the process of presentation?
Yes, you can say.
Oh, okay.
You can ask the question because it doesn't work.
Yeah, students, if you have any questions, please, you can ask directly through the chat or through the talking directly.
I don't know why it's not moving. One moment, I don't know why, what's wrong. You see my PowerPoint, but not the rest. Eh? It doesn't move. I will stop sharing again. I'll try to share again. Yeah. I don't know why my computer doesn't react on my commands. I can do it like this also, no problem. I don't know why it's going. Okay, so we talked about the qualitative and the quantitative differences, but we also so we have several possible methods to get to know your customer or your actually your client or the firm. So you have actually survey methods, like face-to-face interview, street interview, by the phone, actually asking, also send documents on paper, internet inquiry by mail or by social media. I think this is something that everybody knows and we like and win sometimes things. This is actually asking people and also getting engaged them. But also you have the observational methods. The observational methods, I have to be patient. The observational methods can be a qualitative interview, but also a service safari. So this means that you have really several options that you look into how you experience something. And when you go to the supermarket, what is actually your safari that you do? Also shadowing is looking and observing people. You have neuromarketing, eye tracking. You have a lot of observational and survey methods. This is not a limited list. This is actually some examples that I can give you. The final choice that you make for the method is will depend on several factors. Eh? It depends on your budget. It will depend on the costs. It always depends on the timing you have. And maybe you have a list of your target group, etc. So the each choice that you made and each method that you choose has advantages and disadvantages. Eh? For example, if you have a telephone inquiry, this means that you know, sometimes you don't. The person will not respond to you, and you don't have to ask complex questions because on the phone they don't understand. On the phone, people will not give you their phone number. Sometimes you have privacy issues for that, for example. Also, face to face on the street, this is not everybody is on the streets. Think about the COVID and the Corona period that we are having now. So this means if you have to conduct face to face interviews, this is really a hard and difficult method today. And if you observe and use the method of observation, it means also it goes very in depth and very slower. So this means that you have to have more time to do that. And the question remains also about representativeness. I'm trying to again, I don't know why my it doesn't move. I have to be patient. I'm sorry. So if you ask, you have to realize that something is never perfect. Eh? Like also a questionnaire is not perfect. Eh? The perfect questionnaire doesn't exist. This is actually a list of all the options that you have. You can have open questions that are more like, why are you doing this? Or why are you buying this? And a closed end is just like you have to do multiple choice questions or identification questions. These are all possible questions that you can integrate in your survey or in your questionnaire. I can give you some topics that you have to be beware of, that you have to be clear and also precise in your formulation. And also, you only ask one question at a time. So beware of questions that you do actually immediately in one sentence, two questions. It confuses your person that you are interviewing. Don't use also very difficult words. Eh? If you have, for example, the word nutrition, this is for some people really difficult. For scientific people, the word nutrition is easy. But if you just say about food, this is really familiar language. It's simple. So you have to ask these questions also. And always, and this is something that is in general for all market research, try to be objective. Try to be neutral. So every answer that your person gives you is a good answer. So convince him that what he thinks is a good thing, and it's not that it has to be approved by you. It has to be objective. Yeah. Another thing that is important. So I hope my computer will react again. Yeah, don't forget to pretest it. If you don't pretest it, most of the time you don't get a second chance to ask again. So we have to pretest it. Yeah. Step three. So we have done step one, identify the problem. Step two, designing actually your market research and choosing the methods. And now we are actually into step three of the six steps, that we have to select a sample of the target population. It depends really on the time and the budget that you have, and also on which persons. Like the example I gave to you, you want to know the opinion of senior persons. Yeah, I think the population in Belgium 11 million. It's smaller, of course, than in Indonesia. But still, if you want to ask everybody, that is, it is not possible. And it's just the same if you do it in Belgium or Indonesia. To ask everybody, it's not possible. So you have to select some persons and you have to select a sample. Yeah? And it's really important that you identify your population as good as possible. Eh? You can do that with demographical issues, the age, the area that they live, etc., but also on behavioral and it also it's important that you try to be as accurate as possible. This is something is also important. Sometimes we say in preparation with your sample that you create, for example, three persona, that is identifying the person. So this is actually an extract that sometimes we use in Belgium, at our university, but also in the Antwerp Management School, that you can see that this is maybe a type of person that you are thinking about, a type of consumer, and then you have to fill in the blanks, like loves, dreams of, personalia, also the goal, the context, the behavior, etc. Okay, so like I said, the sampling process is really important because you want to be representative. It's important that you can compare actually your sample that you made with your population, with your total population. So you have to define the social demographical characteristics, but also the behavioral characteristics. Is it something, for example, that people are consuming, or something that they are not interested in? Like, for example, I gave the example that people can be vegetarian, but they can also be more gastronomic and therefore not buying your meat in the supermarket. Okay. Then also looking for a sampling frame. Sometimes it's possible to get a list of your population. If you don't have issues like personal data collection, etc., because in Europe the regulation is very strict on that, that you don't get the personal data for privacy issues, they don't get that. But if it's your own customers, like for example, you do a satisfactory research, or my client satisfactory of my product, for example, for the maintenance of the car, for example, then probably you will have a list of all your customers. So if you have a list of all your customers, it's really easy to do the sampling process. Yeah. Okay. And then also you have to determine the sample size. The sample size, this can be a statistical calculation. This is software that I use to calculate the sample and also the confidence level. This, I mean, normally is a whole course and a whole lesson and not a guest lecture. So I will not really make it too difficult for you this afternoon. So I mean, you have to calculate and there are formulations to do that to determine the sample size. But as I said earlier on, 300, 400, 400 people are actually sometimes enough to have really a good sample. But it has to be actually defined and by several demographical characters. You have also really a whole lecture I can do about sample selection, etc. But it's not for today, that's okay. So the next step, now you know what is the problem, you know which method you will use, and then actually you have already looked where you have to found your persons and the sampling persons, and then actually you have to do it now. Step four is actually act now and go and collect your data. You have to do your field work, your field work. It means so that after you have pre-tested your questionnaire or your observation, and maybe you have done some adaptations, that actually you go on the field and you actually gather your data. First of all, you have to consider who is going to gather your data. So you have to do some kind of a briefing if you're going to use students, for example. So this means that actually you have to do a briefing for them, that they are also aware of what is the topic and the problem, etc. So you have to brief the person and the students that you are using. And then also you have the supervision. Actually, are you going to supervise the students that you are paying to do that, yes or not? Or actually other persons, are you going to supervise them, yes or no? This is a choice that you make. And also you have to decide on how long you will do the data gathering. It is, for example, a survey that you do on Facebook, for example, in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, you can gather all your data you need. And sometimes you already have 1,000 responses already. So this is possible that with social media, you have a really short period, a lot of people. But another thing, if you already do observations, to get 500 people, this will take a lot of time. Sometimes also you have to realize also what kind of software do we have to use to collect our data. For example, I don't know if you know that, but I think this is something that is globally known, is SurveyMonkey. This is really a good program and really good software. Also, you have versions that the university provides normally and cheap versions that you can buy. But also Google Forms, this is something that most of the people know also. So automatically you gather and you put your data in this software and you can use it. Yeah, okay. Next one, no, the other side, okay. When you do your fieldwork, you have sometimes errors or difficulties. Yeah? For example, people, like if you have the topic of hygiene or charity, like I told you on the video, it can be that they are conscious or really unconscious that they do not respond well. Yeah, but something they don't want to respond. And these are kinds of errors. Yeah, so people refuse, or maybe they are not there because you made an appointment and still they told me call me in between this or that hour, but they are not there. So you have to resolve this, and you have to look for solutions. So which kind of solutions that you can do? Is if you are really also there, your students know it, they can help you to explain the question. It's also very important that you pre-tested your questions and then you can adapt it. And also try to be set a general atmosphere or a general context, and then you go into the specific ones. For example, I can ask you, did you go to the supermarket yesterday? And then you can say, yes, I went, yeah, or not. And that maybe, did you buy a cleaning product, for example? So this is really a specific question that you do. Another thing that you can do is call back, try again. Another thing that is solution is substitution. What does that mean? You select another person who is really alike the original person, but you try to find another person that can help you. So actually you ask again, or otherwise you ask another person. And sometimes it's really sad, but you couldn't sometimes do nothing. If you have done several efforts of already collecting your data, sometimes you just have to stop collecting it. You don't have any solution, but you have to call back at least try to contact the people three times. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So step five now. You have all your data, and we say, okay, let's analyze our results that we have. You have also, again, three steps that you have to do. First step is actually the data cleaning. Some questions are not answered. So are they complete? No, they are not complete. Sometimes people are not consistent. If you actually do a survey through Facebook, sometimes people are lazy and they just want to add dots and they are not consistent. So you have to ask extra questions by controlling actually if they are aware of filling in your survey. And actually, were your questions comprehensive? Did they understand what you were meaning? Sometimes if you ask for something and you used too complex words, people do not understand, And this is also data that you don't can use. So after the data cleaning, you have actually a second step, and then to compare, actually. So what are you going to do? You're going to test your representativeness of the sample that you have. Exactly, if you have, for example, 500 persons that reacted on your survey, and actually you are talking about the global seniors, and you have 500 seniors, then you have to look, actually, is this compatible? Is this actually, do we have the similar characteristics of this 500 persons who are also in the population? This can be by age, it can be by behavioral data like consumption or something like area or something like that. Okay. Step three afterwards, after you have tested that actually the data are valid, then you have to use data analysis software. You can do it by Excel, for example. Sometimes in SurveyMonkey or Google Forms, you have really automatically statistics that you can do, but also it's also possible actually to do it with SPSS statistics to search for descriptive statistics, cross tabulations, and other correlations. Yeah, here you have on this slide you can see some ways to analyze and present your results. For example, you have the descriptive analysis. So we have the absolute numbers. You can present it in bar charts or pie charts, and also relative data or relative numbers. This is actually percentage. Yeah? And then we have the cross tabulations. Like this is an extract for SPSS that you have to see, for example, do you live on campus, off campus, yes or no? So you see we conducted a survey and we have had a response of 388, but we see that actually here you have ranking and a different results. Yeah, then you have to maybe have a selection if you have to a correlation between the data, and but this is really again statistics, etc. Yeah, okay. The last and final step then is actually then to communicate your findings and recommendations. Yeah? You have already. How are you going to do that? In your reports or actually your presentation, you again use those building blocks and those steps that we had for to report your findings. Also, it's important to use visuals, like I told you, like bar and pie charts for your presentation. Yeah. And also it's important to make a statement, dare to do that. If you say, for example, senior citizens are likely to stay home until 70 years and they adapt this and that, dare to make a statement and say, okay, as a firm, you have to invest, for example, in elevators, or you have to invest in this or that. That is important, like for food for seniors that they keep healthy, for example. So dare to make a statement this. Yeah. And try also to focus on your original objective. Eh? Like I told you, seniors habitation and they want to stay at home. So actually it is true or false. During your research, you really can prove with your data that this is really something that is correct or wasn't correct. Yeah? So you have to present it to your clients maybe, or to your board, or maybe just to several professors that you have to do that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So we're almost through the theoretical part of my guest lecture. So I want you to repeat again the six steps. So the first step was identifying the problem. The second is designing the study. The third is selecting a sample of the target population. The fourth is then doing it, gathering the data. Five is analyzing the results. And sixth is communicating the findings and recommendations. Okay, I promised you that I would show you again a little example of what we did with some of my students. And I have actually one case. This case is FoodSaver. So FoodSaver, this was a non-profit organization that made actually to their goal that actually to reduce food waste and also increase social employment. And this was a logo that we also designed for them with another classroom, etc. Okay, a lot of food in all of the world is thrown away, and so this is important that we reduce this waste. Okay, so if I what was actually the idea, or what was actually the concept? Yeah. We had a lot of food processing factories, especially with vegetables, and they chose to focus on the mushrooms. Yeah? So you have the steels of the mushrooms, but also deformed products that normally don't get into the supermarket. They are just thrown away. So they said, why can't we turn these steels and actually the deformed products into croquettes, or maybe vegetarian burgers? And so we reduce food waste and it gets into the marketplace, and so we can even have an economic model on this. Okay. So what was actually the objective for the students then at Vives University? They had to search and ask actually what was the market potential for these products. Yeah, so they have to do interviews and actually look for a quantitative and a qualitative research on the consumer side. Oh, I'm sorry, consumer side, but also in the retailer side. Okay, so what were actually the results? This is actually a Dutch site, of course, but it helps you. They found about 500 consumers. And they interviewed 23 retailers and 20 alternative retailers. What is, for example, an alternative retailer? This is like, for example, HelloFresh. They are also delivering food at people, but maybe they are also interested. Or, for example, local little local shops, but that not are part of a big supermarket multinational. So actually they asked, this was a question, are you prepared to eat and buy these croquettes? And 80% of the consumers said yes, we are interested in buying this. This was actually about the price. This was then also one, how would retailers prefer to sell it? And this was the croquettes and the burgers. They said as appetizer or actually as a main dish or a little snack or etc. So the students made up a model and they made up a best case scenario for, and they said that actually the market potential was bigger for the mushroom croquettes, and they had to weigh between 80 and 120 grams. They have to have a label that it had to be biological, not deep, not frozen, but they had to be fresh and artisanal, and it had to be packed in 3 to 5 parts. So actually, it has to be as an appetizer or a little snack, and people prefer when you fry these mushrooms. Yeah. So and it has to be possible to keep fresh between 5 and 6 days. So this was actually a way that he presented it, and also the way that they found out their results. Yeah. Okay. So finally, I come to my general conclusion of actually my guest lecture. First of all, I can say that we started off with giving a movie about big data, because this big data is really important for strategic marketing. Yes, but still, big traditional market research is important in many situations. This is still important in many situations. So if you want to conduct a good inquiry, you should really use this scientific method of market research. You have to draft it really, really carefully out. Yeah? And what we say? We have actually six steps. Eh? It consists the design of six steps, and each step has its own consideration. Eh? You have to think about the cost, about the timing, but you have to think also about the representativeness. Yeah? This is also that is the population and also the target group. Yeah. Okay. So actually, we are almost at at the finish. So it means that actually, I would like to ask for more participation. I don't know if you have on the chat more. I will just try to stop sharing for one moment. One moment, sharing. Mm-hmm. Okay. So actually, this went really good. I think really maybe a bit too fast. I talked, but I want to do now a little quiz with all of the participants. Would it be possible?
Sure. Yes? Sure. Yeah.
Sure? Okay. So actually, I will try to share my Mentimeter now. I hope this will work out good. One moment.
Okay, students, please prepare your connection to Menti so you can answer the question presented by Dr. Valerie Ritz.
I think some students, yeah, I have already three persons that answered the first, so this is really good. So I will try to share my screen now again with, yes, to work. Okay, so I have now already four students that are went to Mentimeter and actually use the code 702070. So what is the most important in market research? Data, taste, competitor. So this first question is not really already the quiz. It's also a startup really to know and to see that I have enough participants for the quiz. I have seen that you are with about 170 persons. So actually, if I only have 8, this is not a good success. So I will wait and then we can do the quiz further on. I have already 10 persons, so. Consumer, yes, this is the word cloud. Volume, velocity, yes, and variety. This comes from the big data, yes, data research, surveys, consumers and competitors. Scientific method, yes. I see the answers is getting in. Target market is also an interesting word. So, yeah. How is it conducted is very important, yes, indeed. Yeah. Yeah, we have 61 persons already. I wait for the rest now. It's a bit, yes. Should I stop when I get 100 or continue?
It's up to you, Dr. Valerie. But I think it's best to know from the whole participants.
The whole group, yes. Yeah. We will wait. It's no, for me, it's no problem. Because I prefer the more participants, of course. Eh? Like you see, the sun is coming up now. Eh? You have more light.
Yeah, for all the participants, for the one that hasn't submitted the answer, you can open the Menti with the code of 70, 20, 70, and 0.
So you can also repeat the same answer. It doesn't matter at this moment. Eh? So it's really to get everybody on track for the quiz. So if we have people that are not able to join, it's a pity. But now I know that with this word cloud, it doesn't, it's not a big issue that you are not participating. But with quiz, it's more interesting with to see a leaderboard, etc. So we have 95 people already that are participating. Okay, maybe it stopped now. No. 101. Maybe I can start the quiz anyhow now, or I'll just wait again. I think there's still people are trying to put it in, so maybe I wait again a bit.
Yeah, because most of the students are working from home, so I don't know, maybe the internet connection puts the concern about this one.
Of course, I understand. Did you enjoy the lecture so far?
Yes, yes, of course.
Yes, I don't know. It's difficult to know what is actually the knowledge of the students.
So while we are waiting, Dr. Valerie, there is one question from Mr. Rohim.
Yes.
And maybe you can answer about these questions. He asking about, if I want to test a new product to the customer and want to know their response about this product, what data collection method is best to use? Should I use the quantitative or the qualitative?
For a new product, I think at first you do the qualitative. Eh? So you actually, I'm really fond of focus groups. I didn't explain this on my lecture, but I think this is really interesting that maybe you can ask the person and in a group and really to try to have some insights from the person. Is it really a product or a service? I think it's really important that you do at first a qualitative observation and also asking the experience, etc. Because you have to go in deep and depth. And afterwards, if you know already the first things that about the experiences of your product, then you go on a more a larger scale and you have actually a quantitative research.
Okay.
Does
Dr. Valerie answer explain about your curiosity? Can you talk, Mr. Rohim? Prof. Rohim? Hello? Yeah, I believe most of the students still not confident enough, Dr. Valerie, to express the questions.
I know. It's just the same here with the Belgian students. even though it's the new normal that we have to do online connections and online education, but still they are more afraid to talk in public.
Yeah, another question from Dwika. You want to talk directly, Dwika?
Yes, sir. I would like to ask Dr. Valerie myself. May I?
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Fadil and Dr. Valerie. My question is, from the material that you have given to us, you said that we have to convince our respondent of the research about that the about their answer is okay, is neutral and
yes.
No wrong answer or no right answer.
Yes,
it's all neutral. And what do you think, what is the best method we can do to convince our respondent to answer it to answer it honestly using their own mind, not being
I think it's
leading
very important to say, but yes, it's a very good question. I think that if you are actually trying to convince your respondent of to give his own opinion, that it's really important that actually the interviewer is really neutral and or the interview is not present even. So you can give him actually some questionnaires. Yeah. So if you say that you are not present, then they are not afraid that you will judge them by their answer. So if you are really as an interviewer and as a researcher present with the interview, it's difficult to get more an objective answer. So I think you have to use methods that are more like writing or actually on Facebook. The problem with today's online research is that you have to gain some interest. So this is why sometimes we tell that the students or to firms that they have to do a kind of incentive. So to motivate the people to join actually your, to give a present, etc. But still you have to be conscious that if they only are participating in your survey for the present that they can get, or the quiz, they are just really, so you have to really focus on what data they put in. Yeah. So actually, is it a genuine answer or not? Is it clear, my answer?
Yeah, Dr. Valerie, it's clear. So if I may reconfirm, the answer is we have to use several methods that are guaranteed the honest information or the honest opinion from our respondent. And in addition, we can use several kind of appreciation, maybe like money or another thing we can use to motivate the respondent in answering the survey.
Yeah,
okay.
Thank you,
Dr. Valerie.
Thank you for your question also.
Okay, any more questions?
Maybe we can do the quiz now further. I have 116 persons that have reacted. What do you think?
I think this is the delay number, but we can continue, Prof, if you want to continue for the next slide. So we can have 116.
Yes, we have a group that is sufficient enough. Okay, so actually just now, now I have three questions to ask every student about my lecture, but also about market research. So you have to choose one of the three answers that you think is right, and at the end you will see who has won something. Okay, so let's start. Mm-hmm. just wait that everybody has, I have 80 persons. 83, 5, so I wait to start. He had 118, so I will wait a bit. So everybody, I hope that with the timing that I made, it's going to be okay. I'll just wait again. Okay, I will start the quiz. No, wait, delay. Okay, I will launch the question now. Why doesn't big data replace traditional market research? So first question is too much ad blocking, no data available for nonprofit organizations, or big data is not accurate enough. Okay, so 14 people did it correctly. Too much ad blocking. This is indeed also true that this is, but it doesn't, it is a reason, but it doesn't replace it completely. And that no data available for nonprofit organizations is also a reason why you should do traditional market research. But actually, it's the main reason that big data doesn't replace traditional market research is because it's not accurate enough, eh? Because they don't have the behavioral factors, for example, and also our behaviors changes too much, because of ad blocking, they don't know and they can't be accurate. Eh? Okay, next question. Okay, everybody is ready. I have 107. Now, in choosing the best method, which factor determines your representative the most? The research topic, the list available of target groups, or budget and timing? So which factor or factors determine the most? Yeah, the topic is of course very important. So everybody said, most of the person said actually the topic, but this is also true. But actually, every time when you do market research, if you have money, you can do a lot of things, and you have a lot of time, you can do a lot of things. So this means that actually the budget and the timing determines really the most. Yeah? List of the target people, that is also, it helps you a lot and it gains you a lot of insight on forehand. So both the other responses were not completely wrong, but if we say the most is actually the budget and the timing. Yeah, okay. So final question. Yes. Which step in scientific approach of market research is the most important? Step 2, designing the study. Step 4, gathering the data. Or step 5, the analyzing of the results. Answers were divided. Yeah, okay. So step 1, because step 1 actually is your preparation. And if you don't prepare and choose your methods really good, the other things, step 4 and step 5, Will depend on it. So actually, this is why the other steps, of course, you have to gather the data. If you don't gather the data, you haven't done any market research. But if you are not well prepared, this is actually for the scientific part, the most important thing. Okay, let's see the leaderboard. Okay, so Sebastian, I don't know who he is, but he has actually gained the most points. So congratulations on that. And also, it was really nice to do this kind of quiz with you. Okay, so I will stop sharing again, and I will return to the main screen for everybody. Yeah, maybe there are no other questions. I don't know if it was answered. Yes. I have a new question. Did I respond the first one? The last, I think I didn't respond again. Related to the big data collection, what's your view about privacy issues, especially on this IoT area where something seems connected and can be monitored? Yes. Privacy, it's a big thing actually, and I think it's really important that we could keep some kind of privacy. My personal opinion is that we don't have to be open too much to big data collection, because actually you are squeezed into a part of a corner, and it gives you less freedom actually to be yourself, and also less freedom to explore more things. Because if you are constantly monitored, and they are actually having some kind of a profile from you, does this mean that automatically you will get those ads and those products that are actually they think are good for you? But I don't think that at that moment you get the opportunity to get the real new products or the real difference between the things. So I think it's actually sometimes a bit dangerous. So this is important to keep some kind of privacy and actually to engage in ad blocking. It's maybe difficult for the firms and the companies that want to have money from you, but still I think it's your own personality is and your own privacy is important.
Yeah, okay, we have another participants that want to ask a question from Irfan. You raise your hand, so
thank you for the opportunity. Well, my name is Irfan. For Ms. Flory, I have a question. At the early of the class, you said that data, especially big data, is really important and for marketing purpose. But I believe also creativity is also important for the marketing purpose. So what do you think, like, which one is the most important, like data or creativity? As far as I know, that creativity is the one who engages the customer. So I'm kind of curious about this. Thank you for the
question. Yes, thank you for your question, Irfan. Creativity is a really big concept, and it's really important in market research to have a new idea. And that is also why qualitative research is more and more gaining more insights and gaining more importance in the world. The big data actually helps firms easier to be creative and to gain the insights, because not everybody is capable or has the talent to be as creative as possible. So actually somebody who is actually in business design or design thinking is like a golden person for a firm. but that this is really difficult. And since we are just over all the world have a lot of importance on mathematics, etc., I think therefore also you should consider the big data platforms. Does this answer your question?
Yes, Miss, absolutely. Thank you for the answer.
Are you a creative person?
Well, I guess not.
It's difficult, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Students, is there any question again from you? This is the gold opportunity for you to get the insight from the research methodology, because you are taking the research method class, and this is one way to get the insight to create your research proposal. So any questions from the students? So Professor Valerie, from the teacher's perspective, what is your suggestion to encourage the student to take, for example, like in our place in Department of Business Management, the major approach to conduct the research is by using the quantitative method, but how to motivate the students to start taking the qualitative method, because sometimes the way to solve the research question is by conducting the qualitative method. So how about the way to
the students?
Yes.
Yes.
Because okay. I feel I'm failing to motivate them.
I understand. It's easier for students to really conduct surveys. They just use the software and they go ahead and they use the SurveyMonkey, and it's easier. But the qualitative research, like I said, you have to convince them by actually showing how creative they can be. Yeah. So most of the time I try to work in groups, yeah? Because I think if they work in groups, they are more confident to try something new and to try something. But the groups can't be that big, yeah? Because if you have a group, let's say, of 7 students, then it's really difficult also to have several students that actually are participating. I'll always have then one student who is more dominating the others. So I think if you let them work in small groups, and also what I do also in my classes, if there is no COVID or Corona issue, I really let them work in little groups in the classroom, and actually do together with them a brainstorming session. I think also a brainstorming session helps them to be creative. And so I let them think creatively with several methods and turn flip classrooms and turn around with tables then, so that they actually don't sit anymore in this brick aulas, and that they are actually forced to work with, let's say, 5 on a topic, and then actually discuss it with the other. But I think this is really interesting, but giving the Corona and the COVID time now, it's really difficult because, yeah, we can't have any face-to-face contact.
Yeah, I guess the Corona really constrains a lot for the education process, because we cannot contact directly, and some features of teaching is limited to online class, so we cannot do some physical games or something else.
Yes.
Okay, we have another question, Professor Farley, from the Tasha. I have a question regarding the market research in Belgium. Which one is the difference between the market research in Belgium and Indonesia? And have you already know about the consumer behavior in Indonesia? So Tasha, maybe you can start to elaborate more about your question, because honestly, I'm still confused about these questions. Tasha, mm-hmm. can you explain more about these questions?
Okay, so I'm sorry that I cannot open up my camera because of the signal. So I have a question. Can you elaborate more about the market research in Belgium and Indonesia, and have you already know about the consumer behavior in Indonesia? I mean, like do you know the difference, and can you
Something that I thank you for your question, E. This is something also new a bit for me. So actually Indonesia is a country for me not well known, and so actually I know some things about the religion and the differences and eating habits, etc., and the differences in kitchen. It's nice to know, but actually doing market research in Indonesia is something I have never done. Maybe we can start up a project. I don't mind to do that on with my students and with your students, actually, to gain some insights. Why not? The difference between. I see here in Belgium, and I think also in Europe, because I've done also guest lectures and in France, for example, and also in Holland, etc., in the Netherlands, and so I have some experience in Europe, but actually not outside of Europe. But here in Europe, we actually are trying to get more into the qualitative way instead of the quantitative, because we see internationally that this gains more behavioral questions, because they really want to know about the behavior more than actually about the numbers, as we say. So maybe we can start up a project.
Okay, Tasya, does Professor Valerie answers give you the insight about the curiosity you're asking for?
Yes, sir. So thank you for the answer, Dr. Valerie.
Okay, maybe this one is the last question before we stop the question session. We have Joshua.
Okay, sir.
To ask the question for Professor Valerie.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. So my question, I think the result of the research we must deliver by using the paper, but I think the many students, or include me, it's hard to write a good paper with the systematic or the good structure of paper. So do you have any suggestion how to improve our writing skill to use write?
Yes. Yeah, so actually it's true that writing a scientific paper is difficult, because especially I said that actually when you are actually conducting your survey, you actually should use for your respondent the language that is as similar and as familiar and as simple as possible. But actually when you are writing your report, I always think that actually like in the beginning, I said you have to use these six steps, and also use these six steps also in your report. So actually, the first part is describing the problem. So this means that you have to do a lot of desk research. Yeah? So you have to look on several platforms like Google Scholar, for example, for studies that also are in this kind. And actually, when reading on this desk research and people that already have done, for example, similar studies, this will help you to actually do your own good report. You have, it's not that how can I say, you don't have to be always very innovative. It's nice to be innovative, but actually sometimes when you have a good basic structure and you copy it from another, the structure, I mean, but not the content, of course, but there's the structure, it will help you to be more scientific. Does this answer your question?
Thank you very much.
Thank you also, Joshua.
Yeah, okay. By the end of the Joshua question, so we come to the end of the guest lecture series session with Dr. Valerie Ritz. Dr. Valerie Ritz, thank you very much for the wonderful presentation. I hope we can get a lot of insight from your presentation. And also, we will pass the ceremony to Master of Ceremony to close the session of the guest lecture.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Satria and Dr. Valerie Ritz. Well, ladies and gentlemen, time flies so fast that our event today has come to an end. Sorry if there are questions we couldn't answer due to time limitation. Please don't hesitate to let us know by email to mbusiness@its.ac.id. We would like to express our great appreciation for our special speaker, Dr. Valerie Ritz, who already shared her knowledge, a very comprehensive and enjoyable presentation about market research in practice to us. And also, thank you to Dr. Satria Fadil Persada for leading today's session. We also would like to thank all the participants today. We hope everyone enjoy an insightful and productive meeting. Once again, thank you, Dr. Valerie Ritz, who has provided such a great lecture for us. We are very grateful to have you in this international guest lecture. Okay, that was the end of the day. I hope you found this afternoon's presentation informative and useful. Also, please be sure to complete your feedback form on the link located in the chat room. But before we close this session, we would like to invite you all to the virtual group photo. So please kindly share your best smile by turning on the video. Well, okay, I will start counting from the slide from the page one. Okay. Are you ready? Okay. 3, 2, 1. Next page. 3, 2, 1. Okay, I think it's enough. Okay, thank you so much. On behalf of this organizing committee as the MC, we would like to apologize if there are inconveniences that might be happening during this event. My name is Maria Angelia Krishna Wijayanti. As MC, say goodbye and wish everyone for the best. Thank you for spending your time with us this afternoon. Have a good day.
Okay, thank you, Maria. Thank you, Dr. Valerie. Thank you for all the students and participants. I forgot to mention, Dr. Valerie, can we get your presentation PowerPoint?
No problem. I send it by email?
Oh, okay, I will check it. Yeah, you can send by email.
Or what do you prefer?
Email is okay. I can distribute the material to the students.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
If there are students that want to visit Belgium or study in Belgium, or don't hesitate also to contact us. Eh?
Okay, thank you very much. So the presentation session is ended. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Bye.